truth, and most importantly, storyteller, Werner Herzog.
Ladies and gentlemen, I have to thank the Patent Committee and above all John Vickers, who got me into this mess. And of course, Inder Mohan Virk, who has done all the technical sides and all the spirit that brought me here. I have to thank the president of the university, who has been very, very kind to me. And I have accepted this invitation with some sort of anticipation, some sort of hesitation, because I'm not a man of academia. I have been so much in conflict with academia that I founded my own film school, the Rogue Film School, which has only a few things that I actually taught. At the very beginning, I teach aspiring filmmakers how to pick locks and get into places where they have to get in, and I teach them how to forge documents. A film like Fitzcarraldo could not have been made without a major forgery of a shooting permit, which allowed me pretty much everything after I was stopped by military on moving and navigating on Rio Marañón in the northern part of Peru, close to the Ecuadorian border. I was even shot at, a young soldier, had the order from a colonel who led this camp to open fire because I ignored the signs to stop. And a frightened 17-year-old barefoot native Indian soldier actually opened fire at me, and I better surrendered and talked to the colonel, and he asked me to stop and turn around, and I said, Colonel, I do have a permit to be here, and I have a permit to shoot here. And he said, show it to me, and I said, unfortunately, this is in an office in Lima. I can bring it to you in 3 or 4 days, I can be back. And I came back with a document that was 4 pages long, on very beautiful stationery, notarius, actually with a signed stationery from the President of the Republic himself. The document at the end was signed with 3 signatures. One was Belaunde, El Presidente de la Republica, and stamps and seals, and then his chief of his chancellery and a notary had also signed it, and a lot of stamps. And I said to the colonel, my colonel, read this now, and handed it over to him, and he just went through it very quickly and looked at the last page, and there was a signature of the president. He saluted to me and said, Casale, move on. So that, in fact, made a film like Fitzcarraldo possible. I'm here tonight to talk about ecstatic truth, the ecstasy, of course about fact as well, facts and truth, because they are not necessarily related. Facts do not necessarily constitute truth. Otherwise, the film directory of Manhattan would be the book of books. But it has 4 million entries that are factually correct and are verifiably correct, and yet it doesn't inspire anyone. And I do not wish my worst enemy to read the entire film directory of Manhattan. So I have, of course, spent some time into understanding what are the postulates for a film and where can you find a deeper truth which lies somehow behind things, which can be discovered, which can be articulated. Not in all cases, you have to really work very intensively and search with great fervor. And it's sometimes like a gift of God, it has fallen into my lap. Of course, I was also searching for it. And we have to start with this fact, which in a way has influenced our daily lives a lot, and that is a massive onslaught on our sense of reality. There's reality TV, there's Photoshop, there are digital effects in cinema, we have credible depiction of dinosaurs in cinema, which is a fantastic tool. We have virtual realities in the internet, we have video games, and we have things that are completely new. Our sense of reality is challenged like never before in such a short span of time. And of course it has created confusions and insecurities. And I would like to mention one incident which gave me to think, and I have not finished thinking about it. About 30 years ago in Venice, in Los Angeles, at the beach of Los Angeles, I spent an evening at the house of a friend, and all of a sudden a helicopter started to circle, and the searchlight was down on us. We were in the garden and had grilled some hot dogs. And there was this voice from the helicopter, loudspeaker, get into the house, take cover, go inside, move inside. And only the next day we learned what had happened, only a corner away from where we were at a restaurant. A young kid, about 13 or 14 years old, with a skateboard, was loitering outside of the restaurant. The first couple that left, a young couple that left around 9 p.m., or one of the first couples leaving, he confronted them with a gun, shot them both, and killed, I think, the man. The woman survived. He killed the man and shouted, "This is for real, this is for real," and fled on his skateboard. What is interesting about this case is that this young kid was not out for robbing. He was not taking money. Apparently he wanted to make a point. This is not a video game, this is for real. So it has stuck to me, and of course I have wrestled with the question, what constitutes truth in cinema? And cinema verite, which is very much fact-oriented, has had its day. It had its great time in the 1960s, and ultimately it was the answer of the 1960s. But today we have a new situation, and filmmaking in particular has to find a new attitude, a new position towards the elements that constitutes our reality, and deep behind it, what constitutes truth. So finally, I was sick and tired doing battle with cinema verite people, and I wrote a manifesto which is called the Minnesota Declaration. I wrote this very quickly during a night. I was jet-lagged and in Italy and couldn't sleep, turned on the television set, and there was a lousy, really stupid documentary, and I thought, this is what never should be shown again on television. But until today you have the same things going on. And then I was up again at 3 in the morning, and on Italian television you can see hardcore pornos. And I switched around, all of a sudden there's a hardcore porno, and I thought, finally, this is the naked truth. There's something much more direct, much more physical, much more truthful than all these phony documentaries. And I wrote the Minnesota Declaration, in fact, because I was invited to Minnesota, to Minneapolis, to the Walker Art Center, and I read, I didn't want to come with empty hands, and read to the audience the Minnesota Declaration and asked for being accepted, this should be accepted by way of acclamation, and I got the acclamation for the first time in my life. I had 100% response in favor of what I did. The Minnesota Declaration, Truth and Fact in Documentary Cinema. and it's called Lessons of Darkness, which later became a film, title of a film. One, by dint of declaration, the so-called cinema verite is devoid of verity. It reaches a merely superficial truth, the truth of accountants, that has really miffed the cinema verite people, because I do battle with them and I call them the accountants of truth. Has really stung them. Then I just go randomly through it. Three, cinema verite confounds fact and truth and thus plows only stones. And yet, facts sometimes have a strange and bizarre power that makes the inherent truth seem unbelievable. Four, has a strange short one, a dictum. Fact creates norms and truth illumination. Five, a deeper strata of truth in cinema, and there's such a thing as poetic ecstatic truth. It is mysterious and elusive and can be reached only through fabrication and imagination and stylization. And this is an important point because it has really influenced what I'm doing, and I will show some excerpts of films, and I will also read some texts to you that have this kind of ecstasy of truth in it. Then something that doesn't really belong to cinema, but I put it anyway into it. Seven, tourism is sin, and travel on foot virtue. End of sentence. But there's a lot of experience in it because I started traveling on foot from age 15 on. I mean, long distances, not as a backpacker, not as a traveler on foot as you would expect, but in the very ancient sense of traveling on foot. And what I learned from this is that it became very, very clear to me that the world reveals itself to those who travel on foot. And therefore, I think, and tourism, of course, has created so many catastrophic destructions in foreign cultures. It is not healthy, so it is quite obvious that tourism is sin. By the way, I shared this thought with Bruce Chatwin, whose books I really love, and one of his books I made into a film, the book about the Viceroy of Widor, which is Cobra Verde in my films. Then something which is strange, but I wrote it because I was in Minnesota, and at that time Jesse Ventura was just elected. I actually liked the man because he was a former bodyguard of the Rolling Stones, and he met his wife in a biker's bar, and he was a studio wrestler. He was one of the WrestleMania early ones and stylized himself as a villain, and I really liked him for that. Now, eight, Minnesota Declaration. Each year at springtime, scores of people on snowmobiles crash through the melting ice on the lakes of Minnesota and drown. Pressure is mounting on the new governor to pass a protective law. He, the former wrestler and bodyguard, has the only sage answer to this quote, "You can't legislate stupidity." So, 10, the moon is dull. Mother Nature doesn't call, doesn't speak to you. You hear this always from these new age bozos. Mother Nature speaks to you. The moon is dull. Mother Nature doesn't call, doesn't speak to you, although a glacier eventually farts. And they actually do that because they move, and it's very, very strange to hear a glacier fart. And then it continues, and don't you listen to the song of life. And this is a direct quote from a famous actress, Hollywood actress, I don't want to name her name, and she did at age 80, she did a film on herself, and now she was asked from the interviewer, Miss, I I avoid the name now. Can you pass something on to all the young new generations in the generations to come? And she pretends to be thinking and thinking, and tears well up in her eyes. And after a long, long, long pause of fake thinking, she says, "Listen to the song of life." I mean, it can't get any worse. Now, I have an answer to that. Number 11, we ought to be grateful that the universe out there knows no smile. Then 12, and it ends with 12, life in the oceans must be sheer hell, a vast, merciless hell of permanent and immediate danger. So much of hell that during evolution some species, including man, crawled flat onto some small continents of solid land where the lessons of darkness continue. So that's has become known to me very recently is a writer who I will quote in one or two passages, short passages, who has been quite important for me. And it's a new discovery. His name is J.A. Baker, and he wrote the book The Peregrine, which was published in 1967. And we know nothing about the man who wrote it. We don't even know the year when he died. Nothing biographically has come down to us. And he observed peregrine falcons, which were at the verge at that time, because of pesticides, at the verge of extinction. And Baker has written prose that you do not find in many decades, as a man who writes prose of unimaginable beauty and intensity. And he has a direct and immediate sense of ecstasy. His writing is more intense and incantatory, and the act of bird watching becomes one of a sacred ritual. The Peregrine, irrelevant for Peregrine, is not a book about watching bird, it is a book about becoming a bird. Early on, Baker sets out his manifesto of pursuit, and I quote, "Wherever he goes this winter," and he means the peregrine falcon, "wherever he goes this winter, I will follow him. I will share the fear and the exaltation and the boredom of the hunting life. I will follow him till my predatory human shape no longer darkens in terror the shaken kaleidoscope of color that stains the deep fovea of his brilliant eye. My pagan head shall sink into the winter land, and there be purified." It's very, very strange and beautiful. And he writes, I quote again, "The body of a wood pigeon lay breast upward on a mass of soft white feathers. The head had been eaten. The bones were still dark red, the blood still wet. I found myself crouching over the kill like a mantling hawk. My eyes turned quickly about, alert for the walking heads of men. Unconsciously, I was imitating the movements of a hawk as in some primitive ritual, the hunter becoming the thing he hunts. We live in these days in the open the same ecstatic, fearful life. We shun men." All of a sudden he writes in plural, "we," as if he had become a fellow hawk. A falcon, sorry. And there's some sort of a metamorphosis, an ecstatic metamorphosis, where he steps outside of his own human limitations and morphs into a peregrine falcon. And then I just read at random a few things that I just found this afternoon. "Under the wind, a wren in sunlight among fallen leaves in a dry ditch seemed suddenly divine, like a small brown priest in a parish of dead leaves and wintry hedges, devout till death. It's just very, very beautiful how he writes. The valley, the valley sinks into mist. Or do I have another more beautiful even? But I can read anywhere, just read where I end up. The valley sinks into mist and the yellow orbital ring of the horizon closes over the glaring cornea of the sun. The eastern ridge blooms purple, then fades into inimical black. The earth exhales into the cold dusk. Frost forms in hollows shaded from the afterglow. Owls wake and call. The first stars hover and drift down. Like a roosting hawk, I listen to silence and gaze in the dark. So it's a very, very significant writer who has become important for me, because I had the feeling that a filmmaker should, in fact, read this book. The intensity of watching the world out there, and the love of being engaged with what he sees, is something you have to have as a filmmaker, and I believe you have to have the same sort of intensity and ecstasy when you are a writer. But it has become known to me only last year. It's all of a sudden as if I had found a fellow in spirit. Anyway, I could read the whole book to you, but I won't. It is, of course, invention and fabrication that can lead to a deeper level of truth.